Assalamualaikum and welcome to the first session at the Jasmine Hall, which is titled Power of the Fourth State, which shall be moderated by Mr. the noted journalist, author, Mr. Ghazi sir. Can you hear me now? Welcome to the first session here at the Jasmine Hall, which is titled Power of the Fourth State, and which shall be hosted and moderated by noted journalist and author, Mr. Ghazi Salahuddin, and he will be introducing the rest of the panelists to you.
Thank you so much. We have four very distinguished panelists here to discuss power of the fourth state. And I think there would be, Rizvi, are there boys' bios can be shown? Let us begin with Mr. Rasul Bakhsh, Rais. A very prominent social scientist and someone who can be called a public intellectual. And he has been teaching and writing columns and a very serious observer of what is happening in Pakistan. Shall we move? And then we have Meghan Davidson Gladly. Have I pronounced you correctly? And she is a very distinguished journalist and she knows Pakistan very well. Particularly, she has been writing about social minorities in this country. For instance, I remember reading her piece on Karokari in this country on what you call honor killing and how women are denied the right to marry the men of their choice. After that, we have Matthieu Aikins, who is a Canadian journalist, and you've been reporting from Pakistan also.
Yes, yes, sir.
And you've been based in Islamabad?
In Kabul, actually.
Yes.
So most of my work is in Afghanistan.
Mostly, okay. So we have Matthieu Aikins, and then we have Saeed Shah, a very prominent journalist in the sense that he is based in Islamabad, reports for Wall Street Journal, and is a very familiar name when it comes to reporting from this country. Now the idea is the title that we have, Power of the Fourth State. Perhaps the idea was to look at the fourth state or the media in its historical perspective and then come down to what is the power of the media at this time. I think we could refer to Pakistan specifically, or we could, according to what you think, take a wider view of the role of the media and how it changing society and perhaps how it is documenting this change, and what is your perspective on what it can do and how the present situation, particularly when you look at Pakistan, the war on terror is being sort of the narrative in the media, and whether it has contributed to any war against terror, any promotion of democratic ideas and practices. Let me begin. I think what we should do is, we have not much time. I would ask the panelists first to give a brief presentation of around 5 minutes, and then perhaps then we can come to questions and answer, and that I think would be a more interesting part of the session. May I now ask Mr. Rasul Bakhsh Rais to express his views on a very rather cryptic and wide angle power of the fourth state. Please, Rasul Bakhsh Rais, sir.
Thank you, Salahuddin sir. In 5 minutes, I'm going to look at some of the fundamental issues concerning this fourth state. One is, I think I will start with that the role that media plays in every society is enormous. It is the most important instrument. extremely powerful, and its power can't be understood by ordinary people. One has to really look at what is happening as a consequence of the media in the society. And that, I think, will explain you what I'm going to say now. The second, I think, important point is that, and this is a question I'm posing, is it an autonomous actor in every society, or is it an instrument that powerful social classes that control economy, society, and politics control it and use it for their own purposes? I take rather a deterministic view of media, and my view of the media is that it is for some purpose, whether it is entertainment from Hollywood to TV talk shows and even documentaries. They have a purpose. And then we have to understand whose purpose it is that media would like to really play that that role, or that promote that purpose. If I look at what happens in the societies and the role that media plays, at least in 4 or 5 different areas, then you will understand that whose instrument it can be or has been, and whether or not it is autonomous or it is a tool or instrument, and what power it plays. One is the role of ideas in the society. Ideas are extremely important. What kind of a society would the dominant elite structures in the society would like to visualize and create? Historically, they have used media as one of the instruments. From earlier times, when there were only print magazines and newspapers, then were the books, and also it got into education as well, that you have to authenticate and legitimize certain ideas, and you have to unauthenticate and delegitimize certain ideas, because those ideas would confirm the second very important point, legitimacy of the system and legitimacy of the elite that go on in that society. So that people have allegiance to the political order that a dominant elite in the society has created. And media plays that very important role in socializing one generation after another generation. And the socialization process is extremely important in confirming legitimacy of the system, of the political order, or a political ideology that the dominant elites have thought would be good for them and good for the society. It may be their self-interest, as it may be their vision of the society. Thirdly, I think very important is the role that media plays, is that that in the creation and recreation of cultures throughout the world, media has plays extremely important role. You may think that an advertisement of pizza, or Pizza Hut, Coca-Cola, or some consumer item is simply an innocent act, and these people, these corporations want to sell something and you are going to buy it. Actually, the media has been used for the last 100 years or more, since the, I think, invention of radio, to sell things. But selling things, creating a consumer culture, a market, an economy in their vision, is about also creating and changing the way we live, the way we think about material goods and material objectives, the way we think about success. And even very basic ideas about what is good for us as an individual or as a society. So culture is an extremely important area. One last 2 points and I will stop there. The other is that that media, when I say that it is an instrument, it is. But at the same time, the market economy and capitalism, and also one of the foundational ideas of freedom, also create a space for you and me, for the ordinary people. That is why, because then the media channels have to compete. And in competing, they have to be instrument of one or another. I mean, for instance, CNN and Fox News, if you look at how the things go about in American society, what kind of representation of ideas, representation of basic core values of the society, and what type of vision of a good world and a good society they are trying to create, they represent different constituencies. When they represent different constituencies, they are in competition. When they are in competition, they create a space for you and me in that competition, where freedom, expression of these things are not only possible, but are promoted as something good. Having given you some basic thoughts, let me talk about Pakistan. It is a new player in this country, you have to keep in mind. Being a new player, and rather many players in one category, there is a competition over control. It's not the corporate world, like in the United States, that controls it. It's not the state anymore that controls it. It is not the businessman with an interest in ratings and selling things and using that ratings for charging higher for the commercials that they run. It is not the extremist only that really wants to appropriate the whole place. So we are in an influx as a society, in a process of change and transition. And then those who happen to be the masters behind the media channels are those who sit at TV talk shows. They don't have a very clear idea about how powerful this instrument is and what they want to do with this. And therefore, you see a confusion, too much confusion in the media, and therefore, I would like to watch it carefully. What will come as a consequence of this confusion and this undefined, unfocused, an anarchic struggle for control. The confusion is that you have those who preach violence, hatred, intolerance, and come on the media are given free access, free space, free time, and rather the media channels want them to be there. Right? Now, is it celebration of freedom? Or is it simply creating a space for extremism? Because there is no clarity in the minds of those who are behind the media or those who are sitting and raising questions. But rather, if you look at many of these talk shows, deliberately they would like to create a situation where there is a conflict. So here I don't think that there is a celebration of pluralism and diversity and understanding, but rather creating a culture of conflict and you know, it's an honest disagreement of opinion is again a part of human freedom, and we would like to celebrate that, and we may have that here on this panel. But then creating space for fighting, where you see anger and color of the face changing and the language and the words also changing, is something about confusion and lack of clarity. It's going to be, I think, a contested arena for some time to come, unless we see that whether there are streams and patterns that are controlled by different elements within the society in order to express themselves, religion, political elites, and even criminals. Who are establishing television stations and radio stations. I don't want to name them. And the kind of character they would like to place before the cameras and will become a national celebrity before you may have no integrity, may have no vision, may not have any ideology where they may have anchored themselves. So I have a very, very pessimistic view of the media, and I would like to stop here. At the same time, it is extremely powerful tool. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Rasul Bakhsh Rais. And now we come to Meghan Davidson-Ladley. And you heard Mr. Rais say that he finds too much confusion in the media. Can you make some sense of it?
I'm not sure about that, but...
Let's see if everyone can hear you. Yes.
I think that, at its best, media can be, it's a large dialogue, going back to sort of Habermas and the idea of the public square. It's going to be confusing to a certain extent, just because it should be a place of many voices. But at the same time, I don't think we can talk generally about media without recognizing that it's a huge term. You're dealing with broadcast media, you're dealing with print, you're dealing with online. And all of those are sort of accessing different groups and tapping into sort of different social spaces. And I also think you get into issues of domestic versus international media, and certainly that comes into play with Pakistan and how it's viewed within the wider world. I think predominantly you have the lens of security, which comes out a lot within the international sphere. And certain issues end up being highlighted more than others. Concerns around gender, the war on terror, all of that receives more attention internationally than the Karachi Literary Festival, perhaps. And that's not necessarily a positive thing, but I think that's also a reality. So I think that it becomes complicated when you, specifically speaking about Pakistan, you're dealing with so many different voices, which is fantastic. I mean, the culture of media here is great. You have a really vibrant print media and radio, as well as online. But how much of the population is actually tapping into that? I think, something like 16% of the population has regularly access to the online world. So even something like going on Facebook, which for some people is a source of catching up on the news, Facebook might be the most popular site, but how many people can really tap into that? And then there's so many different languages here. So you're dealing with regional print, regional dialects, as well as Urdu and English. And it's fantastic that there are so many voices, but I think it's only natural that there's also going to be that confusion within that sort of space. And unfortunately, a lot of that sort of, wonderful mixture of dialogues becomes very watered down when you go beyond the domestic level. And I think that it's unfortunate that while the media is very, very potent within Pakistan, externally we're only seeing so much of that. And while the international media is very powerful in terms of how it presents Pakistan to the world, it definitely also has limitations. And it's important to remember the different lenses that come into play when we have this discussion at all. But at its best, I think that's what the power of the media is, and that it is a space for different dialogues in different languages. And there will be, inherent conflict in that.
So, I think that's good, and thank you for even referring to the new media and the social media. Now we come to Mr. Matthieu Aikins, and if you see, we have three media practitioners here, and all three of them report for the foreign media. So, and Meghan has referred to how the foreign media looks at Pakistan, introduces Pakistan to the world. Do you do that, or?
I'd like to build on some of the things that Dr. Rasul and Meghan have spoken. Let me see if I can. Yeah, there we go. About by looking at sort of a more practical perspective, let's say, in terms of how journalists might conceive of power in relation to their own work. So if we're talking about power of the press, the question is obviously what kind of power? You know, is it the power to help people in need, or is it the power of a bully? Is it the power to oppose injustice, or is it the power of a court sycophant, right? My point is that, you know, a powerful press is not necessarily the same thing as a good press. I mean, the Chinese state broadcaster, for example, is very powerful. So we're going to talk about power. We should ask, you know, the power to do what? And when it comes to understanding, you know, what is definitely a moral question, I think that there's two important things to consider when you're talking about the moral value of an act of journalism, let's say. The first is a question of audience. Who is your audience? And the second is, what is at stake for you and for them? So let me give you an example of what I mean by audience. In my own work, I'm a Western journalist living in the East. I specifically live in an impoverished country that has an overwhelming Western military and development presence, right? There's a fundamental inequality to that relationship that I try to keep central to my understanding of what kind of discussions are appropriate in front of which audiences. So I definitely have many criticisms of Afghans and their role and responsibility and their own very unfortunate history. And if I'm sitting with some Afghan friends and they start talking about the foreign hand that has always meddled in their country and is responsible for all their misfortunes, I might bring up, you know, their own leaders' fractious and self-serving behavior. Now, if I'm sitting with some Pakistani friends and they're making the same complaints about Afghans and their leaders and Karzai, I might point out, you know, their military's cynical policy with regards to the Taliban, the Mujahideen, and even class interests and privilege, the way that they've structured Pakistan's foreign policy. But if I'm invited to, say, have a talk at a panel in, for example, Washington, D.C., those aren't two arguments that I'm going to stress. As much as they might eat it up, it's not really the appropriate audience for those discussions. Rather, I'm going to talk about the ways that the Americans have partnered with human rights abusing warlords, the way that reckless spending has fueled corruption and totally corrupted Afghan politics, and civilian casualties from night raids and airstrikes. Now, that audience, I'm talking about the DC audience, the American audience, is also who, you know, the subscribers to the magazines that I write for happen to be. So these are themes that also inform my own work. Last article, big article that I worked on was about war crimes by the U.S. Special Forces in Wardak province. I've written about contracting scams or massacres by the Afghan border police. One of the criticisms that I sometimes get is, you know, you're talking about so many bad things that the Afghan government and the Americans have done. Why don't you talk about the Taliban, right? They're doing horrible things, so write about them. And they are doing horrible things. But writing about them, to my audience, I don't believe will make much of a difference. The difference that I want to make as an investigative reporter, well, if I write about, you know, U.S. war crimes, if I write about massacres by the security forces that the Americans are paying for in training in Afghanistan, that might make a difference. It might force some policy change, or at least a moment of self-examination and humility, because my audience is someone who has, you know, the power to make a difference on those issues. If I was writing for an Afghan audience or radical Islamists in Kandahar, then there would be different discussions to be had. So that's what I mean by audience. Now, the second point is about the power to take risks, let's say, because, you know, to say something is morally courageous, there has to be something at stake, right? And for me, I mean, if I criticize the Taliban or, you know, there's nothing really at stake. It's not a risk for me. You know, it's easy to do. But if I investigate and vocally critique, you know, the American armed forces or, let's say, an American policy in Israel, that might run the risk of certain doors being closed to me professionally, right? Now, this is obviously related to the first point about audience and something what in grad schools they might call positionality, which just means that the moral worth of an act of criticism isn't just about it being correct, but it's about your position and the position of your audience. So by that token, I don't think it requires a lot of courage for a Pakistani journalist to criticize the Indian occupation of Kashmir. But for an Indian journalist to do that, that is brave, and it runs a risk, and it also might make a difference, you know? So my point is that, you know, if we're going to talk about power, about moral power, then we should really ask those two questions. In the U.S., you have a very powerful press, powerful both domestically and internationally. But how empowered are American journalists to do the kind of criticism that I'm talking about here, right? And it's the same, you know, you ask the same question of the Pakistani press, right? It's undeniable that in the last decade, the media here has flourished and become very powerful. But how empowered are Pakistani journalists to undertake this sort of criticism? So, you know, just in conclusion, a country where journalists can regularly criticize their own government and their own societies in a way that has a chance to force change and make a difference, that to me is a powerful fourth estate, a morally powerful fourth estate.
Thank you, Matthieu, perhaps I may tell you, he speaks Persian and can impersonate as an Afghan, and he has been doing that. But
I won't do it now.
Sabir Shah, now we come to Sabir Shah, we are pressed for time, but what do you impersonate as?
Well, I'm
reporting for Wall Street Journal.
I'm sort of in between a Pakistani reporter and a foreign reporter in the fact that I've lived all my life abroad of Pakistani origin, right for the foreign press. I'm more optimistic about the Pakistani media than some of my colleagues on the panel. But I do think that the reporting here is undervalued compared to the chat shows. All the power seems to be with the anchors of the chat shows, not much emphasis on reporting, and not so much rigor in the reporting. And, you know, a lot of stories that you try and check out, which are in the local media here, kind of fall apart if you probe too deeply. So I think compared to the way a foreign reporter would work on some of these stories, the media here is often plays it much faster and looser, and reports on things that, you know, we couldn't get away with. In terms of power, I think the things that I noticed the media here reporting on has changed. I think even a few years ago, reporting negatively about the MQM, the military, for instance, and religious extremist groups, was done much less. And less negatively. You see a lot more of that now, and that's led to a situation where the Pakistani media in particular, and to some extent some of the foreign media, is something of a target for Pakistani Taliban. And that's a constant situation where which puts a strain on reporting the whole time. But I do think that the power of the local media has been evident in the last few years in the lawyers' movement, which was more or less completely driven by the media, because it was actually a very small movement portrayed by the media as some kind of national insurrection. When I first got here in 2007, the media was actually gave the what became the Pakistani Taliban, the TTP, a very easy ride. That changed at some point around 2009. And since then, the media has had a very uneasy relationship with militant groups. There is a, I would say, broadly conservative bias in the press here, particularly in the people that choose to come on the chat shows. I was listening to a retired general last night bemoaning the fact that Pakistani women are now wearing jeans. This sort of opinion is, I don't know, seems to be quite common. And the other thing is, of course, because there are so many channels here, the chat shows have to be a form of entertainment. And so, you know, the guests are chosen who will basically fight with each other. I think it, for, you know, to outsiders, it's amazing how many news channels there are in Pakistan. I mean, there's like 24 rolling news channels. If you compare that to Britain, you know, we just have the BBC, really, and Sky News. In America, there are far fewer. So this is not an economic proposition. People are running news channels for the power they can give them. Businessmen use them to, in order to make themselves untouchable, to bully, to get deals, and so on. As far as I can see, most of these channels do not make money. They're there as sort of extensions of the business empires of their proprietors. And in a sense, if you have a news channel, no one can touch you in this country because you can just use it to go out and bully and criticize opponents, the government. And so it's TV, really. It's all about TV here. Newspapers, as far as I can see, really have lost most of their influence.
Thank you, Saeed Shah. You've made some very important points, and I think it is encouraging to find you more optimistic about the media in Pakistan than the rest of us seem to be. And I think another important point that Saeed Shah raised was how reporting is not so rigorous in this country, and there is not so much focus on reporting as it is on talk shows and an opinion. And I think this is one very important feature of the Pakistani media, that its statements and opinions matter more than actual events and facts. And also you talked about the conservative bias in the media and that only the news channels matter. And that brings me to the point that we are constrained to conduct this session in English, because in Pakistan, even though English is the official language, it is the means to empowerment, it is everybody wants to learn and speak English, but not one English language channel, TV channel, was viable in this country. Not one. There were three of them that closed down. So that's an important thing. We don't have very much time. We have about 15, 20 minutes for discussion. But one thing that I would like to raise first before I go to the audience is, you said that TV is the main thing. I think one reason why TV is the main thing is that it is an unlettered society, not very literate, not very educated also, even if it is literate. And also, the reading habits are very poor. So you have television as the only medium that goes to a large number of people. Now, television also caters to the lowest common denominator, because anyone can watch TV. You don't have to be able to read and write to be a viewer. Hasn't that declined the cultural standards in a country? Isn't this something that vulgarizes good taste? I would like each of you to have some comment on how the electronic media, particularly news channels, impact a society that has a low political culture, that's not very literate, and that is also lacks social harmony, is in a state of conflict, where people complain about women wearing jeans. Can you, 2 minutes each?
Well, I think if people are denied education, or they never got the benefit of education, that doesn't mean that they don't have a culture. That doesn't mean they don't have a history. That doesn't mean they don't have historical memory. A language, they have everything. But then their sources of knowledge and information are very different, may not be comparable to the society that we would like to idealize, and that is true. Then coming to your question, I think that the media has played a very important role, particularly the electronic media, in giving information, providing entertainment, and taking politics from major cities into the small houses in the rural communities. There's a great role. But then I'm more interested about the content.
No, but does it not undermine the struggle for enlightenment? And
but actually, with more information, the more confused it might be, It helps people to formulate opinions or formulate ideas without education. And again, if we don't have the benefit of formal education, that doesn't mean that we can't form opinions, or we don't have ideas, or we cannot formulate ideas. But that realm, that sphere of that kind of intellectual exercise within one individual is very limited. Media is playing, you know, media is just not information, media is education as well. From that point of view, I think it is very positive, because you are presenting the world that we learned through books and textbooks, through the visuals that are very powerful to ordinary folks. They know about United States, about Britain, about Germany, about France, about Olympics, about new sports, about the world. I think it's great in that sense.
Thank you. Meghan, we can see media is too much with us. But I was wondering if you would look at this dominance of the media in a society in which rational debate becomes more and more difficult.
I think that, I mean, in terms of access, for instance, the cable channels are fantastic and, as you said, you know, important. But I am also glad that you pointed out again that we are having this panel in English. And I think that the sort of the lack of prioritizing regional languages in terms of literature, and just even in a lot of school situations, is unfortunate. And then perhaps helps to feed into what we are doing now, where you have people turning to, you know, to seek out their news from sources that are probably biased. I mean, I could watch Fox News in the US if I wanted to, and it would be an incredibly biased experience. So it's not to say that it's only here, but I think that there is something about cable media that perhaps lends itself to individuals seeking out news that sort of matches their values and is not necessarily unbiased, and then therefore you're going to end up with individuals who are perhaps more polarized than if there were probably more centralized sources of media.
So Matthieu, with your Afghan experience,
In Afghanistan, of course, the literacy rate is even more is much lower. So there's almost a total dominance of electronic media in terms of the public discourse. I write 10,000 word articles for magazines in the U.S. So I'm definitely a proponent of elevated dialogue. But to bemoan the kind of chaos and illiteracy of these popular television channels, you have to ask, what is the alternative? These are people who are excluded from any sort of participation in the country's discourse and media life before, right? Their illiteracy kept them out, right? So the fact of the matter is that they're going to be part of the debate now. In fact, they deserve to be as citizens of this country, right, with all their warts and everything. And we have to kind of, I think we should celebrate that fact as well, as uncomfortable as it might make us, or yourselves, I shouldn't say us, but I think there's a parallel to be drawn as well to some of the concern over the, you know, increasing conservative nature of public spaces and the Islamicization of the downtown, for example. Is it something that's new, or is it something that is just becoming visible? Is it classes of people who are excluded from these places in the past, who because of the rising middle class or other reasons are now being made visible, but who, you know, who always were like that? So, you know, we have to be careful about scorning it too much, I think, because it does represent a democratization of media.
Thank you. Saeed Shah, you made a very significant observation in your initial remarks when you said that the lawyers' movement was not as huge as the media made it out to be, and it had sort of a great influence. Do you think that media can create these things which are not on the ground?
I think the media is powerful enough to do that. I mean, for instance, Imran Khan, before he became so popular a couple of years ago, was sustained almost entirely by his appearances on television. I mean, he was politically irrelevant, but remained in the national discourse entirely because of television. And I do think that although there is distortion and misinformation in the media aplenty, but the overall effect is that ordinary people are much better informed about what's going on in the country, about different arguments and so on. And the media has been broadly, for instance, supportive of democracy in recent years. And I think it's a good thing.
Thank you. We have some time for questions. And if you raise your hand and the volunteer will bring the mic to you. Yahan se shuru kar lete hain. Please.
My name is Ravi Ali. I work as a reporter.
Can you stand up and introduce yourself before asking the question?
My name is Ravi Ali. I work as a reporter for the Express Tribune. I wanted to ask Matthieu that though you've said that you don't write much about the Taliban, but in case when you do write about them and they're unhappy with your stories, what kind of reaction do you get from them? Because in our country, they're now targeting media organizations and killing people for wanting a, you know, better coverage and a positive coverage. So have you ever faced this challenge? And what do you think Pakistani journalists should do? Should they give more coverage to these terrorists? Should they give positive coverage? What should they do?
Thank you. I think Saeed Shah, it was addressed to you. No, but would you like?
No. I mean, I think the Taliban, if they find me, are going to kidnap me and chop off my head, regardless of whether I'm writing about them or not, as a foreigner. So that's not really an issue. But it's a very tricky question, because, which is why I try to, throw it back to questions of who is your audience, you know, because condemning something, you have to think of it in terms of what is its power, and I think that for Pakistani journalists, you know, obviously, especially the sectarian stuff, this needs to be highlighted and condemned. There's no question about that. But if you look at, you know, what really requires moral courage to do in this country, and where might you have a real effect, I think the proper targets of criticism are probably things like the military, the FCR system in the Fatah, which is totally neocolonial, class privilege, all these things that are actually not really talked about. But I think if people, you know, look at the situation in the Fatah, they would see that these are more at the root of the problem with militancy. I'm sure my other panelists have something to say.
Yes.
Hi. Hello. My name is Rabinwath and I'm a student of media. My question is, traditionally, the primary threat that media faced regarding censorship was from the state. But as state has gradually weakened, and currently in Pakistan it's too weak, and media is gaining strength. And at the same time it's facing threats from like within the society, from terrorists, from the right wing, etc. So this threat of censorship, what is the current direction and where is it going? With regard to state versus society.
Who would you like to comment on
any
this?
Any of the panelists, especially Rasul, Bakhsh, Rais.
Would you like to... did you get...
I would say that it's... it's self-censorship now rather than censorship. So the channels do hold back on some topics, including the military. For instance, you hardly ever read anything about corruption in the military. You read plenty about corruption in the politicians. With the Taliban, they have supposedly a hit list of journalists, Pakistani journalists. As the lady in the audience was saying, three employees of a news channel were killed here in Karachi last month. So journalists are, it seems to me, self-censoring now.
Please, go ahead. After this.
My name is Shiraz Khan and I'm with Express Media Group. And my question is for Shah Saab. Shah Saab, what do you think objective journalism is, and do you see it happening in Pakistan?
The what?
Objective journalism. What is objective journalism to you, and do you see it happening in Pakistan?
I think the question was objective journalism. Yeah.
Objective journalism, you said. Journalism by its very... I mean, it has to be objective. What is objective journalism to you? Perhaps he has in mind your remarks about how you indulge in self-censorship.
I think in any country there's a debate about objective journalism, not just here. I mean, I suppose it's an aspiration perhaps for journalists, but you know, every newspaper on its opinion pages has their views. Hopefully, on the news pages you can keep views out of it, but I don't think any reporter... I mean, you're reporting anything, you're including some facts, excluding others, including some voices, excluding others. I mean, I don't think any journalism, you could say, is absolutely objective.
Mm-hmm. Gee. Yeah. No, first...
My name is and I freelance. Can you dilate upon the alternate media or the social media which is gaining some strength and its challenge to the fourth estate?
Would you take this up? Social media, you said dilate on?
Social media is increasingly getting more powerful in the sense that it is challenging the narrative which is being put forth by the conventional media.
Yes, the power and the influence of social media vis-a-vis the mainstream traditional media. Would you like to make some?
Certainly. I think that social media has definitely, particularly within the last, you know, 5 or 6 years, grown instruments hugely. When you think about, you know, the role that Twitter played in the Arab Spring, it's... You know, it's really grown into its own. However, I think we still have a role. Obviously, there are citizen journalists as well, but it's important to sort of make sure that you're verifying the information that's coming in through social media. It's a really great tool for getting information on the ground, particularly in situations where there's conflict, where journalists might have a difficult time getting to, or where something's just erupted, and you know, people are there right now and they can give you feedback on exactly what the situation is, but it's still something that has to be scrutinized, certainly. And it's also then tricky because while mobile phone technology is so widespread, again, in terms of internet access, particularly here, you're still dealing with a huge swath of the population that doesn't have access to that. So there are still limitations for sure.
Hello. My name is Rasul Ali Khan Abbasi, and I'm a marketing executive at a private firm. It has been our understanding that media is the fourth pillar of the state. The topic over here is the power of the fourth estate. Does it mean that there are independent institutions that are more powerful than the state that actually encompasses them? For example, media is supposed to be a fourth state, but it's the fourth pillar of the state, but it's called the fourth state. Does it mean there are states within a state working independently?
Is media a state within the state?
Yes.
Is media as strong that it could be called a state within the state?
Exactly.
I don't think it is a state within the state, but it is referred to as one of the pillars of the state. Not that it is controlled by the state, but rather it has created a power for itself. Information is extremely important. Analysis, ideas I have mentioned. And the modern nation states have come to terms with this free media. And rather than controlling it, they listen to it and also take the point of view of the opposition. And media, keep in mind that media is not only for the opposition, it is also for the state functionaries as well. So it promotes that healthy, competitive debate and discourses in the society. And then the society can determine for itself who is right, who is wrong, and accept or reject a particular point of view. Of course, this is a march of history and it's come with modern technologies and very powerful instrument that many, many players would use this player. So I don't think that it plays a role other than that point.
I think we have time for two more questions.
Yashamun Ahmed, a regular person just attending the conference. I just want to get some input from Rasul Saab and Mood Saab about the history that you said that this news media is the kid, 10-year-old kid, basically, and both of you have a lot of experience. What you're seeing, because the way I follow a lot of international channels, news becomes the views channel. That's the history internationally too. And you're saying also that it's being lobbied by a lot of businessmen here. What you're seeing in the next 5 years happening in our news media, would it be a views media or it can be a news media and keep a decent intact, just like Fox and MSNBC or BBC, it's a controlled media, we all know, but even living in US or those who are living in England knows about it. So what your expectation in the 5 years, what you're seeing the media in Pakistan will be? Will it be a news channel or a views channel? Thank you.
Saeed Shah, would you take this on?
Yeah, I'm not sure I completely follow the question, but it seems to me in any country, Matt gave the example of China, and unless it's some kind of totalitarian society, I mean, media is not controlled as such. I mean, there's just too much. Journalists are too enterprising. I don't think you can say that the media is controlled here. But I would think that presumably a lot of the current TV news channels that exist today will shut down in the next few years because they're not economically viable.
Thank you. And the last question.
Sir, I have just one question that due to advertising, there's a factor in Pakistan's media that is sensationalism. I'm looking at the European media. You see that there's no so much involvement of advertisement. So can we say that the alternative way out of this media can be the reducing the gap between advertising and profit sharing between cable operators and media owners?
You're addressing this.
No, I'm asking that. Can that be a question for Mr. Matthieu?
So you're asking, is there a way out of sensationalism? I think it was an excellent point that Saeed made, which is that reporting often doesn't get enough value in this country. And in a lot of places, reporting is actually quite sensational. I mean, look at this whole NSA story with Glenn Greenwald and Edward Snowden. It's exciting, it's interesting, it's sensational, but it's about real reporting. And so reporting can be sensational. I think you need to really work on developing investigative standards here. I'll use an example. I won't use the names because I don't think it's relevant. But recently in the news, there was an investigative story about an abuse of an expense account or a counterterrorism fund, right? And it was a great story or scoop, but it was reported in such a baffling way. There was no sourcing. Nothing was really sort of laid out. And you actually should be quite meticulous about these things. So the whole story sort of fizzled, and as it was actually reduced to a sort of series of counter-accusations on Twitter, and perhaps some sensational, you know, back and forth on chat shows. So I think you need to work on making the reporting really stand on its own. That would be a way out of sensationalism.
Thank you, and I think we have to, yes, we have to conclude or something.
One last question.
Okay, why not? Why not?
Thank you. My question,
let us see you.
Educationist, my question, especially to Rasul Basahab, is doesn't the media owe a certain responsibility to society, not just to create sensations, but to actually provide facts, and then perhaps allow a little debate in society, bring in the common man and have discussions with him, not just, you know, sound bites as we have in our media, at least electronic media. The newspapers are very different, but electronic media is a whole different kettle of fish.
Well, we can take that as a very valid comment, and we have to conclude this session, and I'm grateful to our panelists, all four of them, Mr. Rasul Bakhsh, Rais, Meghan Davidson, Latley, Matthieu, Aikins, Saeed Shah, and I don't know how to sum it up, but I think the issue is so broad, and there are so many questions that are in our mind about the media, particularly how the media is conducting itself in Pakistan, and the issues that relate to it, that we cannot perhaps be covering all aspects of it. But we had an interesting discussion, and I think that you will take something away from it. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for attending this session. We will be taking a break for Namaz, and we will be starting our second session at 2:15, which will be Pani Parinde or Moth, readings and conversation with Mr. Ansar Hussain Tarak. And this will be moderated by Irfan Javed. In 45 minutes after Namaz. See you then. Thank you.